hello. This is VK3SL. Test transmission on 160 metres and 2 metres. I think it's working on 2 metres tonight. I hope it is. It's been a bit of a strange experience there with 2. It's been doing all sorts of weird things. But anyhow, good evening to all. This is VK3SL. We're just testing, of course. It's nothing to do with entertainment here. It's a 160 metre, primarily 160 metre test, and of course there's a streaming service too if you want to look that up. It's on the QRZ page. Just look up my call sign and you'll find it there. Right, as the time-honoured tradition dictates, we will have something from the 1920s to kickstart. So why not have Mr. Prosuit's latest? This is Broadway Melody with Arthur Rosebery's Orchestra with Len Lees. Let's have a listen. That was Arthur Rosebery and his orchestra with Len Lees, the vocalist, from 1929. And we heard Broadway Melody on a parlophonium. And that's courtesy of Mr. Prosuit. And some nice arrangements there. It was really well recorded too. I like the way the saxophone section blends with the strings. It's always a sign of a good arranger who knows how to voice things well. And yeah, I thought that was particularly effective. Good tempo. It's a nice tempo for that song. Yay. All right. So what else? I'm warming up. It was hard to get away from the fire, folks. There was a lovely fire inside, sitting by the fire. And I thought, 11:15. Do I? Don't I? Okay. Yes. And so quickly zipped out here and got the gramophone handle and wound all of the machines up. Pulled a few records off the shelves and switched on the putes here, and we have a sort of an ad hoc selection. So not a lot of thought gone into it, but you're used to hearing me say that. All right, so what do we have? A 78. Yes, I think I should play 78s on this program. The real thing, a real shellac disc on a real CE turntable with a real Autophon arm. Mind you, I noticed that the Autophon arm had a cobweb. Yes, cobweb going from it to the wall. So it's a sign of the lack of activity in this room. I think the only thing I've done in this room is to put that old mixer in on the museum shelf, put a few new knobbies and a meter in, and it's sort of sitting there as a bit of an exhibit. So it's come up quite nicely. All right, let's have a look at this. It's What Was I to Do is the name of the track. It's a Benny Kruger record from, looking at the record, I think it probably is from about 1926. It's one of those light beam discs. But he's got a few good saxophone breaks in this, and it's a testimony to the virtuosity of Mr. Kruger. He was a fantastic player. And sort of a leading figure, I suppose, in sort of virtuosic sax playing. There's a few of them in the 20s. Ruby Wyckoff was another. Anyhow, we'll see what we can do here. I'm going to have to move over and switch. There he goes. All a bit strange, all those weird effects. I think he was renowned for his special effects on the saxophone, and I think he was trying to sort of exhibit those, squeeze as many as he could, but it didn't sort of feel that stylistically congruent, I didn't think. Anyhow, Benny Kruger and his band from about 1926 on a Brunswick light beam record. All right, this is VK3SL, distinctly not entertaining anybody at all, but testing on 160 and 2 metres. Now, if anyone would care to give me a little bit of feedback on 2, I'm interested to know, because I had to reset things here, and the 2 metre receivers I've got in this room are not particularly good, so it's it's all a bit ad hocium. So interested to know if I am actually getting out on 2. But we'll continue with 20s Mania. We'll hear Don Voorhees and his orchestra with My Blue Heaven. Now, this is interesting because it has a trombone solo, extensive trombone solo, by none other than Miff Moll, who was in the session. And I think Red Nichols is on this record as well. So, but we do hear Miff Moll, a fantastic trombone player, in that there's a sort of overtone style of playing. It's the style of trombone that Bill Rank played as well. Our White Man background, Bill Rank, we've featured him before. But in this instance, we hear Miff Moll soloing, and yes, this is quite interesting, actually. My Blue Heaven, quite a hot recording too. VK3SL testing. Yeah, that was back 1927. We heard My Blue Heaven with Don Voorhees and his orchestra featuring trombone solo by Miff Moll. What do you think of that? I am enjoying hearing these records. I think the solos in that context, in the context of a dance band, it makes the solo stand out a lot more. So when you've got something that's sort of very constrained, syncopatedly constrained, a solo sort of stands out all the more. That's one of the reasons I like Whiteman's music, which reminds me, I've got a Whiteman lined up, and this one's for Frank. I did find a recording of Dardanella, and this one does feature the Whiteman Orchestra and with Bix and Tram. So we'll hear, that's before they moved to Columbia, so it must be early 1928. And so, yeah, I don't know if this was the record that you used to have, Frank, but maybe, maybe not. There's quite a few different versions, so we might feature a few over the weeks and you might one might resonate with you. But I'd forgotten that this was a Bix record, so I can't even remember what the solo's like. But we'll listen out for it, and yeah, we'll hear the Whiteman Band from 1928 with Dardanella, and I'm VK3SL testing. Was something else.
One of the
No advertisements, please, on the station. Now, that was incredible. Now, what we heard then was a Bix recording that I hadn't heard before, not the one I could recall, and it's really effective. It's great. I'm quite staggered. I'm going to have to listen to it again. I'm sorry, folks. I when I hear something that resonates, I need a second inning sometimes. So I will do that. I'll just go back to the spot. I think it's about 150 or something. And we'll have another listen to this Bix solo. Now, it's got a string bass backing to it. He's really driving. I'm sure that's Steve Brown. He was with the Whiteman Band at that time. I will check. Yes, it was recorded in February of 28. In May, they went to Columbia. Now, looking through the list of musicians on that recording, let's have a look and see who's playing string bass. Steve Brown, yes, from the New York Rhythm Kings. Great slap string player and accompanying Bix of all people, and that is a remarkable Bix solo. It's a little busier, it's a little bit more sort of on the front foot, but this really exemplifies that point I made before, that quite a very structured arrangement, still with lots of textual interest and stuff, but and to hear a really interesting solo in the midst of that, it stands out. I think it's one of the problems I have with some trad jazz is that it's all busy and it's all soloing and it has a sort of a congestion factor. So, which can be a little bit, I can find a bit fatiguing. And I think one reason I do enjoy these 1920s dance band records is that when there is a solo or a solo break, it's in sharp relief to what else is happening around it, the stylized material that happens around it. Anyhow, let's have another listen to that little bit of that wonderful Bixie and Quip in this fabulous stuff, VK3SL testing. That stretching the rhythm, and it puts you on the edge of your seat because you really wonder what he's going to do next, especially harmonically, and especially playing around the beat as he does. That's great material. I think there's a here we go. This is Frankie Trumbo on the sax. Yes, he's very sort of Bixie in his approach as well. Well, there he is again. Well, that's a fine. So thanks, Frank. Thank you for bringing that to my attention. If it's not the record that you are thinking, we will keep looking and we'll see if we can find another version of that too. But I've certainly discovered something. And as I've mentioned before, I used to, when I was young, I had this anthology of Bix recordings. Oh, there was over, I think it was something like 14 or 15 LPs. And I listened to them obsessively. I listened to them over and over and over and over. And I heard all the double, all the takes and everything. And I don't recall hearing that. So that's quite exciting to find that. So new material. Okay, so all right, I thought we might sort of do a bit of a segment tonight since I'm quite disorganized and I've had another mad week of barely having any breathing space. I think it might be nice to sort of chill out with a bit of chamber jazz. And I thought it would be good to pick up on a theme we sort of started last week with Eddie Lang and Joe Venuti. They made so many recordings, and some of them are really interesting. And so maybe we'll start with Eddie Lang's first recording. Yes, we found one. This is a record he made with the Mound City Blue Blowers, sort of a jug band, in 1924. So it's an acoustic, but this is the very first time we hear Eddie Lang. And you can hear he's sort of is more sort of blues oriented. Now, it's interesting that he actually transitioned from violin. He was a violinist and quite a successful violinist. And then as an older person, he transitioned to guitar. But I think he actually met Joe Venuti when he was still playing violin. But that's an interesting story when you think of what an innovator Eddie Lang is on the guitar. He's the first guitarist to actually really play single note melodies. So that's something, a technique he might have picked up from his fiddle playing, that sort of linear concept. But of course, he had wonderful sense of extended chordal patterns as well. But anyhow, let's have a listen to this. This is Mount City Blue Blowers, a very, very early recording with Eddie Lang, the sort of one that got him started. And his story is fascinating, but it's so tragic that he died so young. Anyhow, we'll have a listen. VK3SL testing. Thank you. those blues recordings speak as well as sing. It's one of the advantages of using comb and tissue paper is you can get pretty close to a vocal inflection. Anyhow, let's have another listen to Eddie Lang's time with George. Don't start too soon. We'll just fade this in, I think. Eddie Lang and Lonnie Johnson. Could you tell who Lonnie Johnson and who Eddie Lang were on that recording? Could you distinguish them? There were some interesting sort of textual differences. And I think predominantly Lonnie Johnson had the tune. A few Eddie Lang breaks there, but interesting to hear the two guitarists, important figures, playing another bluesy number. That was actually Midnight Call Blues, and it was recorded in 1929. And we will have a look and see what's next. Yes. Another Eddie Lang. This is sort of more of a rhapsodic sort of solo, a complete solo, recorded in 1927. Just Eddie Lang on his own and a piece, I think he's his own composition, actually. A piece called April Kisses. Thank you. some lovely harmonics at the end. April Kisses, played by Eddie Lang, recorded in 1927. And yeah, a lot of dynamic control in that recording. And it's interesting how well they're captured. I mean, that's just a guitar player, probably had nylon strings. I don't know if they used steel strings at that time. And probably just close mic'd. But it did capture very well. And there's a lot of subtlety in the articulation, which you can hear on that recording. So good to hear. Eddie Lang, really the first jazz guitarist. He's not really playing jazz there. It's more of a sort of a little poppy piece, but very charming, I think. Yeah, let's have a look. What else? There's so many Eddie Lang recordings to choose from. We'll sort of save for some for other weeks as well. Here's one with Tommy and Jimmy Dorsey. This is interesting. This is Eddie Lang fronting a band. And it's a band, yeah, just under his own name, Eddie Lang, and his orchestra. The recording's called Hot Heels. It features the Dorsey brothers. And this is particularly interesting, this record, because it features a trumpet solo by Tommy Dorsey. Now, we always associate Tommy Dorsey as being a trombone player. He's very famous for his very syrupy, smooth, liquid trombone sound. And but not many people know that he actually did play trumpet as well. And there are a few examples. Very hot trumpet player, and he had an incredible range on the trumpet. And so we hear him do a trumpet solo in this. And I think it ends up on a high A or something. It's got some really high notes. You don't usually hear people play high notes. You certainly don't hear high notes from Bix. Bix had a very small range. But here's a rare example of Tommy Dorsey playing the trumpet. I had listened to this earlier in the record, and I thought, wow, this is amazing stuff. And then I realised there was actually Tommy on the trumpet here, but also some Eddie Lang, of course, fronting the band. This is VK3SL, testing and certainly not entertaining on 162 metres and the streaming service.
Thank you.
was, the Hot Heels, Eddie Lang and his orchestra, featuring the Dorsey Brothers, recorded in 1929 on OKA. And Leo McConville was the other trumpet player, and you can hear him at the start sounding very like Bix. He was copying Bix. And that growly trumpet solo, the one that was really rough around the edges, that was actually Tommy Dorsey. So interesting, isn't it? So you're sort of emulating some of the Black Band's Cootie Williams type. Growly, sort of rough-shod playing. But, yeah, it's really effective. Quite enjoyed that record. Yeah, had a raw energy to it, I think. What else? Oh, we should bring Joe Venuti into the picture. Of course, Eddie Lang is sort of really associated with Joe Venuti, the violin player. They recorded together really from the Golgett days right through. And I've got a whole stack of Joe Venuti's lined up here too, but I might save some up and we'll have a feature on him as well on another night. But look, let's hear one of them doing something together. We'll hear a recording of a piece called Doing Things. This is recorded 1928. And Joe Venuti and Eddie Lang. Joe Venuti and Eddie Lang with with Doing Things. That was recorded in 1928. So, yes, I think we'll sort of follow up on their recordings they made together on another evening. I think there's so much material that sort of warrants a program on its own. So we'll stick with Eddie Lang as a sort of feature artist or as the glue in an ensemble and the sort of chamber jazz phenomenon, which is sort of really interesting in the 20s, because what he was doing with the sort of laid-back music was sort of setting the scene for for generations to come after. I mean, it was a completely new thing to have, particularly with the extended harmonies and the sort of the types of chords, types of textures. It's music that was really groundbreaking in many ways. So like that last recording had so much interest in it, in the its harmonic language. Next one's no exception either. This is one of the really remarkable recordings that Bix made with Eddie Lang and Frankie Tremba. This is the three of them. And they did a series of these for OK. They're sort of rather esoteric. They're more experimental records. But this is the frontier. It's the new music from, and you'll hear it. This completely transcends anything else you might hear from the 20s. When you think this was recorded in 1927, it is decades ahead of its time. So we'll hear Ringin' and Twistin', Tram, Bix and Lang. Ringin' and Twistin', Tram, Bix and Lang, recorded in 1927. Of course, Bix was playing piano on that recording for most of it, and then just picked up the trumpet at the very end, just a little break at the end and the ride out. So that's the piano solo is quite excellent, actually. I might play it again. Let's have a listen. We'll have a little listen to Mr. Bix playing that great piano solo, very Ravelian. Here he comes in shortly.
Thank you.
There we go. Needed another dose. All right. So what's next? Oh, yeah. I thought I'd play a recording of I'm Coming Virginia. I think I played this before in one of the earlier programs, but it's one of my favorite chamber jazz recordings. Well, sort of actually it's a more of a band recording, but it has features a solo with Eddie Lang, but also with Bix himself and on the trumpet this time. And this would have to be, I think, one of Bix's most hauntingly beautiful solos. And I promise I won't play it twice. Yeah, it has got so much in the solo. But yes, I've already, if you go back through the vaults, I've waxed lyrical about this somewhere else. So I don't need to say anything else, but it is one of my faves. VK3SL going nuts over Bix. All I can say is thank goodness that was recorded. That was I'm Coming Virginia, Frankie Trumbauer and his orchestra featuring Bix and Eddie Lang. And of course, Frankie Trumbauer himself playing C melody saxophone, an obsolete instrument. Don't even see them anywhere. They're actually being remade in China, apparently. If I was to play saxophone, that's what I'd choose to play. I love the sound of the C melody sax. All right, well, that's our little chamber jazz segment. I've got about another 10 here on the screen. I've just sort of lumped up, but I think we'll save some of those for another time. And, I wouldn't mind playing something with a bit of Japanese feel to it. So I've been looking around, and there's some amazing material here. Early Japanese recordings are abundant, and they're quite fascinating. So I might put one of those G&Ts on in a minute, but look, to set the scene, I'll have to put a comedy record on. This one's flashed up. It's from the show Victoria and her Hussar, and there's a duet with Oscar Denny's and Barbara Dewey with the De Bruyne Summers Band, and it's called song called My Mama from Yokohama. So I think this might be sort of an entrant into the Japanese segment.
Your sentimental oriental ways, incontinental ways, you can express.
I'm Japanese upon my mother's side, but on the other side, I'm French, yes.
Yes?
My dear papa, he from Yokohama, my papa from Gay Paris. He likes mamas, they sleep pajamas, with the address of the day.
Your party cook with coal and acid one, but not an acid one, too sweet by far.
To be compared to Conte Kiko, it seems incredible, but there you are.
Your dear papa came from Yokohama, your papa from Gay Paris, la-la-la-la-la-la. He liked mama, tasty in pyjamas, with the net result, you see.
To make the best of both worlds, that's been my plan, and only blessed is from Japan.
My poor dear mama came from Yokohama, your papa from Gay Paris.
My dear mama
came from Yokohama,
my papa from Gay Paris.
La-la-la-la-la-la.
He liked mama, tasty in pyjamas, with the net result, you see.
Well, that was much more about German cabaret, Weimar Republic cabaret, than Japanese music. But I thought it might to sort of break the ice a little bit. So, quite an upbeat performance there by De Bruyne Summers Band from the show Victoria and Her Hussar. Now, usually the song you hear from that show is Mousy. That gets played a lot. I remember hearing Mousy the first day I walked into 3CR as a 10-year-old. That was the first thing Ralph threw onto the platter. That's from that show. But it's another story. All right, so let's hear some Japanese recordings. Now, I've noticed in the Movie Tone Outtake Archive, there is some amazing early sound footage of Kyoto in 1929, quite a lot of it. And it is such compelling viewing. It is like walking into another time, and it's got sound. And it's got one segment where they actually have some musicians performing. So it's sort of, it's just an outtake, it's just a snapshot. But I think it's worth playing, and we'll have a listen to this from Kyoto in 1929. A few musicians, and they're playing shakuhachi, and they're guitar-like instrument, or lute-type instrument. I can't think of what it's called. Isn't it terrible? I've taught this, and I can't even remember. Anyhow, it's quite authentic, and that's interesting. So let's have a listen via the early movie tone news. Moves onto a street scene, and it's just incredible. You see these people in their traditional costumes, and it couldn't be more different from Japan of today. And it's just got such a provincial feel about it, and just the way they dress, the way they congregate, just the look of the street, the whole atmosphere. It's like looking into another world, and having the sound captured as well just makes it into something remarkable. I think there's a temple scene as well coming up, but I don't think... Here we go, I'll let this play for a bit. Was a scene from a street parade. I actually had a motor car in that parade, so that's probably a venture into the 20th century. One motor car in the entire parade. You see lots of the beautiful umbrellas, the very low profile umbrellas that the women carry. I think it's just women folk carrying umbrellas. Men wearing robes. Sort of a paved street. We'll see if there's anything that has a little more music. I'll jump ahead a little bit. That was a street parade, incidentally, we heard before. Here's another parade here. That last example had some dance moves. We hear some children singing. This, incidentally, is a religious ceremony with monks. Oh, that's all there is of it. All right, so we had some early sound footage of Kyoto in Japan, 1929, courtesy of the Movie Tone archives there. And, we finished with a religious ceremony with the large Buddha. Well, I've looked at it a couple of times, and it's just something so arresting, so much interest in that material. Okay, we'll finish off with this segment with another one of those G&Ts, those gramophone concert records from the early in the century. Now, this one here is The Tale of Tobushika Temple, Part 1, sung by Toyotaka Rosho, and that's released on a Victor record and recorded in Osaka in 1906. So, very provincial, and it's obviously a part of it. It's part one. It's a tale, so I presume it's a part of a longer monologue. But it's got a lot of very subtle inflections in this performance. So hopefully the acoustic recording comes across all right. I'll try and boost the levels a bit. But let's have another listen to one of Fred and Will Geisberg's expedition to Japan in 1906. Okay, we just heard part one of the tale of Tobushika Temple. And a lot of really interesting melismatic inflections in that. And the microtone intonation schemes they used. But it does certainly have a strong pentatonic feel as well. Japanese music I associate very much with the pentatonic scale. Yeah, so we'll save up a few more of those for subsequent weeks because there's a lot of Japanese interest in our midst. And, well, what we'll do now is have a little example from our new resident composer. Now, I'm very excited to say that we have a... someone took a great interest in the some of the more esoteric offerings that we have and has decided to take up a composer in residence, namely Mr. Parker. Peter Parker has been composing music using his drone machine, and he's put together some sort of compound oscillations and made a bit of a track here, which he sent to me. So thanks, Peter. This is good. In fact, it was good to chat with Peter. He's now working, going live and on YouTube. And I happened to be at work and a student didn't turn up. And I clicked on to YouTube and lo and behold, Peter Parker was live. So I was able to join in one of his very first live conversations. And so that's become a new thing for Peter. So good luck with it. I think that's a good venture, and it's something, especially with the broadband, it's something that probably more of us could do. So maybe I'll be setting up a video camera here, and people could see all the junk that I'm sort of have to climb over to do my missions. But no, Peter's certainly on a good trajectory there, and great that he's composing music or putting together stuff. Now, this is interesting because he's decided to use some subtle use of Morse code within the mix. So those of you who can listen and hear Morse code, you'll pick up some interesting call signs of long gone institutions, should I say. So they're sort of hidden in the textures. So, yes, it's an experimental piece. Peter's sort of giving it a go. Now, it does go for a while, so just sort of chill out and have a listen and see what you think. And I think it goes for about 30 minutes. So, looking at the time, that's going to bring us close to the end. I'll tell you what I'll do, Peter. I hope you don't mind. But I might actually foreshorten this a little bit. So... yeah, we'll find somewhere to play the whole thing. Maybe I'll put a link to the whole thing, or we can do something. But I'm just looking at the time, and if I had a 30-minute thing, it would basically write out the show. And I had a couple of other things I wanted to share. So let's just let this happen somewhere around the midpoint. How about that? Is that a good compromise? So, yeah, let's listen to Peter's offering. I don't think he's found a title for this composition, but it's certainly a... sort of an effective idea using his drone machine and more. So, of course, he's been doing a lot of work with induction loops as well, capturing sounds, and I think that that whole idea is something can be exploited as well. Anyhow, this is VK3SL. This is a non-entertainment session on 160 metres and 2 metres and also streaming online on the Broadwave stream. And entertainment intended whatsoever. And this is very much a technical recording, courtesy of one of our alumni.
Thank you.
Okay, that was the music of Donyani, I think. It was off a test record, and Nick's a test record. And before that, we heard Peter Parker's magnum opus. That's his work. Oh, what's it called? Music with Drone... No, let me find it. It has got a title, I've realised now. It's Drone One with Morse Tributes. So there we go. That's the first major composition by Mr. Parker, who has now become the composer in residence here. So we look forward to more offerings from you, Peter, and we'll put them on the playlist and we'll have a bit of a go. I might have to sort of keep them within the 15-minute range. So excuse me having to sort of fade in halfway through that, but enjoyed hearing the Morse tributes, and your drone machine is in full flight there, and maybe we'll hear something with some induction loop samples as well in the future. But I thought that was very, very noble of you to send that through. Very good stuff. All right, so at this point we are sort of in slight, almost wind-up mode. I did have a couple of other things I wanted to play tonight. One of them is the recording. Yes, there's two versions of Chopin's concerto, first concerto, piano concerto, and two very great pianists. I thought it'd be nice to just profile two fine artists and their very different interpretations of his piano concerto number one, Chopin's piano concerto number one. And one of them is from Lipati. Dino Lipati's his fabled 1950 recording in Zurich. I think it's very shortly before he died. And it's a really great performance of the work. And then we might hear a recording of Joseph Hoffmann, probably the pianist that I sort of associate with. I love his interpretations. He also playing the same thing. So I've sort of found a spot of just after the the recapitulation of the first movement of the Chopin. So like a 5-minute sample of each artist playing the same section. So I thought it'd be nice to profile that. So we'll hear Lipati first. Now I should just quickly check Lipati's birth and death. Let's have a look and see. 1950. I think the Zurich performance is at the very, very end. So we'll have a quick check on this. Lipati. And we'll just get some information here. Dino Lipati. And yes, he did die in 1950. So I think this is his final recital. Now, he was literally a skeleton on stage when he gave these last concerts. And I'm not sure if this was the one just weeks before his death. There was one of only days before his death, actually. So let's see if I can get more information here. I don't think there's anything else on the web page, but this has been remastered and it's got better sound than the classic version on EMI, which I've got an LP of. But I do think this is very close to his death. So Dino Lipati, when he was riddled with leukemia, performing the a section of the first piano concerto, and then shortly after we'll compare that to Hoffmann. Now I think they're both wonderful in their own way. I'm not playing these to sort of better one artist against the other. It's more about hearing the variety of approaches to the works. So we'll start with Lipati and then we'll hear Hoffmann, and then we'll see what people think. VK3SL testing.
Thank you.
Yeah, we just heard a remastered recording of Dinu Lipati playing Chopin's Concerto No. 1 in E minor. This is the first movement, actually just the recapitulation of the first movement of that work, and recorded in February 1950. He died later that year, so this was before he became emaciated. There is a recording of him doing a performance just weeks before he died, and they say he was like a skeleton walking on stage and gave this extraordinary performance. But yes, it wasn't that long before he passed. And so extraordinary performance of the Chopin, and I love its space and very eloquent. Now, let's contrast this. Let's hear Joseph Hoffman recorded a few years earlier, about 1936, and playing the recap of the same work. So we'll just hear them in sharp relief and hear how two giants of the keyboard performed the Chopin. This is VK3SL testing.
Thank you.
All right. Yes, we heard Joseph Hoffman from 1936, I think, with his interpretation of the Chopin Piano Concerto No. 1, the E minor, Opus 11. And we, compared that to Dino Lupati in 1950. We heard two interpretations of that piece, both very eloquent, both very poetic, and two remarkable exponents of the keyboard, great aristocratic players from a golden age of pianism, I suppose. That's one way of looking at it, but very individual performances. So it's nice to sort of look at these things in sharp relief sometimes. So there we go. It's getting close to the end. Just want to acknowledge Clint. Thank you for sending me the file, Clint, and the signal report. Yes, I had a very quick look at it before, but I was encaptured by the music I'm playing. So I'll have a good look, listen to it later on. So thank you very much for that. Now, to wind up today, and I think I haven't played any Tebow today, and I think I need to. So here's a remarkable performance of Jacques Thibaud, great violinist, playing Vitali's Chaconne. We've played the Heifetz years ago now. When I first started these missions, we played had a whole series on Heifetz, and we played Heifetz's interpretation, which is just epic beyond words. It's titanic. This one's very different. It's very refined, and it hasn't got that sort of high stature quality, but it's so intimate and so beautiful and so feminine. And that's the wonder of Thibaud's playing, and the being an exponent of the Franco-Belgian school of violin playing. It's a way of playing that particularly resonates with me. So we'll finish with that today, and then I'll listen on Channel D afterwards and see if anyone's about. Haven't had a chance to change over the mitts yet, so the quality won't be good, but I'll have a quick listen and see what's happening. So thank you for your indulgence tonight, peoples. Thank you for tuning in, and thank you for signal reports, and thank you, Mr. Parker, for being composer in residence. And we will stand by next week, probably. We'll see how things go, if I can peel myself away from the fire. And we'll see what's happening. All right. Have a good week, folks. And we'll now finish with Mr. Thibaud.